Recorded Books presents Pocahontas by Francis Mossiker, narrated by Flo Gibson. The author opens with a quote from William Byrd. In the beginning, all America was Virginia. And now, Pocahontas.
Prologue. The founding of Jamestown by the Royal Virginia Company Expedition of 1607 was England's first successful colonial effort, her first permanent settlement in the New World, and constituted her first and major claim in the Western Hemisphere as the 17th century opened. If King Henry VII had literally missed the boat with Columbus by his niggardly rejection of the explorer's proposition to sail west under the Tudor ensign, England would try to recover lost ground and retrieve lost opportunity with another Genoese, John Cabot. Her claim to the North American continent was based on Cabot's having been the first in 1497 to touch the mainland, whereas Columbus had attained merely to the rim of the Antilles. Even after 1497, England slept on her rights, proved laggard in enforcing her claim, allowing almost 100 years to elapse before she moved to implement it. Elizabeth I, granddaughter of Henry VII and first Protestant Queen Regnant of England, would challenge the Papal Bull of 1493, refusing to recognize the right of the Pope to partition the Western Hemisphere between Spain and Portugal. The Queen does not acknowledge that her subjects and those of other nations may be excluded from the Indies on the claim that these have been donated to the King of Spain by the Pope. Queen Elizabeth would point-blank refuse to recognize the papal authority to invest the King of Spain with the New World. England's repulse of the Spanish Armada in 1588 strengthened Elizabeth's hand in maintaining an open-door policy in the Western world. She would nowhere recognize mere rights of discovery. To sail past a hitherto unsighted shore was not enough. Effective occupation was a prerequisite to recognition of sovereignty. France acted on the principles enunciated by England's queen. French and English fishermen fished and fought over the North Atlantic waters. Cartier, 37 years behind Cabot, laid France's claim to Canada in 1534. Holland similarly refused to be excluded from the Indies and also ended the competition for the New World. By the latter half of the 16th century, South and Central America had been effectively occupied, had fallen incontrovertibly under Spanish and/or Portuguese dominion. Spain had furthermore established the first strongholds in the Antilles, although possession of these islands would be disputed for another 200 years. The pace of international competition in North America now began to quicken. In 1565, Spain moved up from her base of power in the center to expel the French from Fort Caroline and to found St. Augustine. Ponce de Leon, in 1513, had claimed and named Florida, the Spaniards' name for the entire continent. The English name for North America would be Virginia. The Virgin Queen honored the broad land with her name and conveyed it, all of it, almost all the Atlantic seaboard north of Spanish Florida, to her gallant, dashing, and mercurial favorite, Sir Walter Raleigh, by letters patent of 1584, entitling him to discover, search, find out, and view such remote, heathen, and barbarous lands, countries, and territories not actually possessed of any Christian prince. But Raleigh's colonization effort, his Roanoke Island plantation, ended in misfortune and mystery. The Roman letters C-R-O carved on a tree trunk high on a cliff were the only clue to the disappearance of the 117 men and women set ashore there in 1587. The next setback for England's colonial aspirations came with the abandonment of the Plymouth Company's Sagadahoc colony, planted at the mouth of the Kennebec River in Maine in 1607, contemporaneously with the Virginia Company's Jamestown venture and very similar in size and scope. The Sagadahoc colony was abandoned after one icy winter. Thus, all England's colonial ambitions rode with the Virginia Company's flagship, the Susan Constant, As she led the two smaller ships of the flotilla out of the Atlantic, past the capes, through the strait, into the Bay of Chesapeake on an April morning in 1607. The sails of the Mayflower would not appear on the American horizon for another 13 years. The Pilgrim's landing at Plymouth Rock was still more than a decade off in the unpredictable future when the Virginia Company's three vessels sailed into the unpredictable waters of the Chesapeake. And that little fleet was two full decades ahead of the first Puritan contingent, which would not arrive in Massachusetts Bay until 1630. It is almost certain that if there had been no Jamestown, there would have been no Plymouth, in the opinion of colonial historian Thomas J. Wurtenbaker. How, then, the Founding Fathers of Massachusetts contrived to steal the thunder from the Founding Fathers of Virginia is not easy to make out. Much of the larceny dates back to the vicious sectionalism of the post-Civil War period, when the Boston Brahmins wrote American history without a South. The legend of the preeminence of the Massachusetts colony began even earlier with the early New England chroniclers and orators who reflected pride in the fact that theirs alone among all the planters had been a distinct, a purely moral purpose, a wholly religious dedication. The Puritans of New England founded a city upon a hill. They were conscious of a worldwide audience, the eyes of all people upon us. Theirs was an errand into the wilderness. 19th-century American literature, notably the versifying of Longfellow, enlarged on this theme, and America seized upon the identification with Puritans and Pilgrims as the most heroic of national origins. Not only was the Puritans' moral purpose loftier than the Virginians, so was their socio-economic status. Although the New Englanders were middling people, of middle-class origin, as were the bulk of the English settlers on this continent, they were men of some substance and of respectable station, the best people under heaven compared to the refuse of the English nation dumped into Virginia. The Virginia contingent consisted of soldiers of fortune, mercenaries, vagabonds, desperadoes, convicts, and debtors. The scum of people, in the words of Sir Francis Bacon, who deplored the raffish crew recruited by the Virginia Company for this colonial enterprise. Modern scholarship in reappraising the Old Dominion has rejected the legend of the rollicking cavalier origins of the Virginia colony. It now questions the imputation of an exclusively imperialistic, exclusively mercantilistic motivation on the part of the founders. Clearly, the Virginia Company was a joint stock company seeking profits for its adventurers, investors, and a new world market for English commerce. But its Royal Charter of 1606 specifies with equal clarity that it was being incorporated for the glory to be achieved in the propagating of Christian religion to such people as yet live in darkness. Clearly, it was a redemptive mission, an evangelical errand, a holy as well as a commercial venture, to sow spirituals and reap temporals, as the logic of 17th-century Christian imperialism was explicated by the Reverend Samuel Purchase, journalist and promoter for the Virginia Company. All the rich endowments of Virginia are wages for all this work, God in wisdom having enriched the savage countries that those riches might be attractives for Christian suitors. The 20th century tends to see the gunboat directly behind the missionary, but it would be a distortion of historical perspective to fail to recognize the validity of the religious impulse in the Elizabethan world where the American colonization movement had its inception. For the first 20 years of the 17th century, the rude triangular fort and huddle of huts on the bank of the James River constituted England's sole precarious toehold on the eastern rim of the vast continent, whose very extent and shape were still unguessed, unexpected. The banks of the James River were to become the jumping-off place for the most massive migration of people in recorded history. No other spot in either hemisphere carries so much significance, for if the colony there had failed, Spain and France ultimately might have divided up all of North America between them, and the United States of America might never have come into being. In the opinion of one authority on colonial America, at Jamestown, If she should succeed in establishing a base, England could begin her struggle for the conquest of the continent. The favor of Pocahontas, favorite daughter of the Powhatan tribal chief, extended to Captain John Smith, to John Rolfe, and to others in that beleaguered wilderness outpost, substantially increased the settlement's chances for survival. Chapter 1. To seek new worlds for gold, for praise, for glory. Sir Walter Raleigh. Landfall came on April 26, 1607. It came at break of day. A fortunate circumstance for 17th-century mariners approaching an uncharted shore in cumbersome ships with unwieldy sails and rudimentary navigational instruments. And it was especially fortunate for this puny fleet of 3 small merchantmen, mustering scarcely 160 tons among them, so battered by storm in recent days that no one was sure of their whereabouts, and the less hardy souls aboard talked of turning back, of abandoning the voyage. But on the 26th day of April, about 4 o'clock in the morning, we descried the land of Virginia, wrote Sir George Percy, the only nobleman in that company of 100-odd English adventurers aboard. Even before the first light of dawn streaked water and sky, even before the lookout in the crow's nest of the flagship Susan Constant could make out the low pine-forested shore, Captain Christopher Newport, himself a redoubtable privateer, a premier commander of his time, could have sensed the loom of the land, the low-hanging clouds, the flurry and shrill of shorebirds, the fragrance wafted far out to sea by offshore winds, a potpourri of bark and berry, leaf and blossom, redbud, wild plum, wild cherry, crabapple, bayberry, grape, and bog magnolia, especially aromatic in a Virginia spring. That first breath of land would be especially sweet to nostrils crusty with brine after the 4 months and more of an Atlantic crossing. They all remarked upon it, all the early mariners and navigators coasting the sweet-smelling new continent. Philip Amidus and Arthur Barlow, captaining Sir Walter Raleigh's first American expedition in 1584, and coming on to soundings off the Carolina Outer Banks in June, breathed deep of that balmy air that smelt as sweet and strong as if we were in a fragrant flower garden. The Italian Giovanni da Verrazzano, on a French exploratory mission up that same Atlantic seaboard some 60 years ahead of Raleigh's, rhapsodized about those same most sweet savors which floated out to him far from the shore. Laureate Michael Drayton must have been reading the logs of the explorers when he extolled the luscious smell of that delicious land in his ode to the Virginia voyage. At the shout from the crow's nest at the crack of dawn, the crew would have rushed from their pallets on the main deck to their stations to wrestle with the sails, to hand, to reef, to steer, while the 71 passengers on the flagship would have roused themselves out of uneasy sleep, out of the dark, dank 5-foot-deep hold, up onto the deck, unfastening their breeches as they jostled toward the rail to relieve their bladders over the side after the long night, to utter heartfelt hosannas, to marvel at the sight of land, the headlands of the Virginia coast looming up ahead. Percy had probably suffered less discomfort than the others. As the 8th son of the 9th Earl of Northumberland, he enjoyed a nobleman's privileges and may well have had space in one of the captain's 2 cabins. But he was no less exultant. As he wrote in his diary, "That same day we entered into the Bay of Chesapeake, directly without let or hindrance." Note, the same Chesapeake, was first reported by Raleigh's explorers in 1584 to 1586. The Spaniards had called it Bahia de Santa Maria. The translation of Indian place names was inconsistent and erratic, as was the orthography of 17th century chronicles, logs, and maps. At or by the big river is an approximation of the Algonquian word Chesapeake. End of note. There we landed, and discovered a little way, discovering fair meadows and goodly tall trees, with such fresh waters running through the woods as I was almost ravished at the first sight thereof. The first sight of the new world ravished them all the newcomers. Their excitement rings out across the pages of 16th and 17th century chronicles, the pages of Hakluyt's principal voyages and Purchas's pilgrims. Mariners and planters alike waxed lyrical about those gallant rivers, stately harbors, those crystal rivers and odoriferous woods. They were wonderstruck by the bounty as well as the beauty of that virgin shore, the goodly woods, the game and wildfowl in incredible abundance. In the world were not the like abundance, to quote Captain Amadis, coasting the Carolinas, already named Arcadia by a poetic Verrazzano. There was poetry in Amadis' log. He noted not only the treacherous reefs and shoals, but also the profusion of summer grapes. The water's edge so overgrown with grapes that the surging waves flowed over them, and the spectacle of a flock of cranes, the most white, startling at the firing of a harquebus, taking wing from the water with such a cry as if an army of men had shouted all together. Ralph Lane, landing on Roanoke Island with another Raleigh expedition in 1587, wrote to the geographer Richard Hakluyt, "We have discovered the mainland to be the goodliest soil under the cope of heaven." Beside that, he continued, "it is the goodliest and most pleasing territory of the world, for the continent is of an huge and unknown greatness." Lane's commander, Sir Richard Grenville, called it this paradise of the world. Columbus had thought he was speaking literally when he called it a terrestrial paradise in his letter to the sovereigns, written in 1498, from what he believed to be the remote perimeter of the Garden of Eden itself. He identified the Orinoco River as the Gihon, one of the four rivers flowing out of Eden. To the Orthodox Christian ear, of course, there was a tinge of heresy in such a suggestion that unredeemed man might have penetrated to even the edge of the terrestrial paradise. Had not the garden gate been barred to man after the fall by an angel with a flaming sword? By another ancient notion, the way to the west had been barred by Hercules, setting up his pillars at the Strait of Gibraltar, or according to Plato's fable, had been blocked by yet another device of the gods, by a shoal of mud, where the lost continent of Atlantis had sunk and settled beneath the waves, for which reason the sea in those parts is impassable and impenetrable. It was not so much the fear of sailing off the edge of the world that impeded westward exploration. The theory of a spherical world had been taught as early as the 6th century. It was rather a sense of trespass and sin, a sense of fear and awe as well as wonder, which men felt at the approach to the land under the western wave. The next great adventure into the unknown would not take place until the 20th century, that into outer space, and only the landscape of the moon would bring men to marvel again as they had at the landscape of America. In the 15th century, the unknown began where the Atlantic shelf dropped off into unfathomed deeps, inaccessible to any soundings yet devised. Beyond there stretched only a vast mystery of waters, bottomless, boundless, untracked, unmarked on the maps of medieval cartographers, save for the decorative figures of blowing and broaching whales, or the protean shapes of flyaway islands, now here, now there, now one, now another, the islands of Antilia, High Brassel, or Bus, appearing up out of, disappearing back into the waves, as travelers' tales caught the fancy of the map-makers or were discredited. The Ecumene, the inhabited world as known to medieval Europe, was tripartite. Europe itself, Asia, and Libya, representing the three parts of the world as divided among the three sons of Noah, the Japhetic, Semitic, and Hamitic. Were a fourth part of the world to exist, were it to be discovered, it would be a Dantesque world, without people, forbidden to mortal men, reserved as the abode of the souls of the blessed en route to paradise. The Isles of the Blessed, the Enchanted or Happy Isles, the Hesperides, the Elysian Fields, as they had been variously known to classic antiquity. Their location, according to Homer, was on the western margin of the earth, according to Hesiod and Pindar, in the western ocean. The Celtic bards pointed west to Avalon as the abode of heroes, of King Arthur slumbering yet a while before his return to Camelot. Such was Europe's recurrent fantasy, unsuppressible dream, inveterate longing for the land at the edge of the world, land of promise, land of the westering sun. To see it with his own eyes, on that early April morning of 1607, moved Captain John Smith, hard-bitten soldier of fortune, world traveler that he was, to exclaim in awe and wonder like the rest, "Heaven and earth never agreed better to frame a place for man's habitation." Under arrest for 13 weeks, since the flotilla had watered at the Canaries in February, on vague and unsubstantiated charges of conspiracy to mutiny, Captain Smith almost missed the sight at landfall. Somehow he managed to escape confinement and make his way to the deck as the flagship rounded a point of land and entered the very mouth of the Bay of Chesapeake, as he reported in his true relation. "The first land we made, we fell with Cape Henry." Sand dunes no sooner sighted than named by the expeditionaries in honor of Prince Henry, elder son and heir apparent to their monarch, James I, first Stuart king, first king of a united England and Scotland. The 100-ton Susan Constant, followed by the 40-ton Godspeed and the 20-ton Discovery, dropped anchor 6 or 8 miles beyond the point of land. Captain Newport led the first small party ashore to penetrate the wall of verdure that stood as sole rampart of the continent, and there to their first encounter with the continent's inhabitants, their first moment of anthropological shock, first confrontation with a totally dissimilar culture. "At night," Sir George Percy, a member of the party, recorded in his diary, "when we were going aboard, there came the savages creeping upon all four from the hills like bears, with their bows in their mouths, who charged us very desperately in the faces and hurt Captain Gabriel Archer in both his hands, and a sailor in two places of the body very dangerously. After they had spent their arrows and felt the sharpness of our shot, they retired into the woods with a great noise and so left us." It was Captain Newport's shot that scattered the savages. He fired single-handed, his other hand lost in a naval engagement on the Spanish Main. It is ironic that Captain Smith, who would be known to history as the first man of the Virginia contingent, was not among those to set foot that first day on Virginia soil. Still in disgrace, still under restraint aboard ship, Smith heard the news second-hand from participants in the shore excursion. "And in that place was the box opened wherein the Council for Virginia was nominated." The nominations had been made in London by the governing board of the Virginia Company, themselves appointees of King James. The list, placed in a sealed box aboard the flagship, included the names of Captain Christopher Newport, Captain Bartholomew Gosnold, Captain John Ratcliffe, Master Edward Mariah Wingfield, Captain John Martin, Captain George Kendall, and Captain John Smith. These were the men selected in London to command the infant colony in Virginia. The first name on the list, Newport's, was a name to cheer, a hero's name along with Drake's in the annals of the sea. He was with Drake on that daring raid into Cadiz Harbor in 1587 to singe the beard of the King of Spain, and on his own in 1592 he captured the Madre de Dios, richest prize ever snatched by an Elizabethan privateer from the Spanish treasure fleet. The Virginia Company had chosen well in naming Newport to the command of this expedition in 1606. It was no mean navigational feat to bring those three frail ships safely across and across together, with no means of maintaining contact at night, through 4 long months in transit, from London on December 20th, 1606, down the Thames, to lie at Hull for almost a month of storm in the Downs, off the coast of Kent, then on the traditional southern or tradewinds route best known to Newport, from Finisterre in France to Finisterre in Spain, southwest to the Canaries, thence in Columbus's wake, due west across the Atlantic to the West Indies, to anchor on March 24, 1607, off Dominica in the Windward Isles. Newport's skill and confidence in bringing the three ships into the Chesapeake in 1607 suggest that he had reconnoitered those waters on previous voyages to America, perhaps en route home from the West Indies in 1605. It was a surprise to no one when the box of orders was unsealed to find the name of Bartholomew Gosnold on the list of council members. Captain of the 40-ton Godspeed, second in command to Newport, he was another old sea dog, privateer, veteran of Western waters, commander of a recent 1603 voyage to the northern coast of the North American continent. Gosnold was furthermore one of the original promoters of the Virginia Company enterprise, one of the first movers of this plantation, according to Captain Smith. Gosnold had spent many years soliciting financial backing and government sanction for this first colony on the Chesapeake, and was probably responsible for recruiting Smith. All three captains of the fleet were named to the council, although the nomination of the third was less popular. The captain of the 20-ton Discovery, the least noteworthy, least stalwart of the three, the one who had lost his bearings and been ready to turn back in the storm just off the Virginia coast, was John Ratcliffe, or rather, John Sicklemore, alias Ratcliffe, traveling west under an assumed name to obscure his involvement in an old-world scandal he hoped to live down in the new, as so many after him were to do. If Ratcliffe Sicklemore sought to shroud his past in mystery, he succeeded. The most assiduous research has failed to turn up a clue as to his origins or family connections. He must have had some navigational experience to have been placed in command of even that tiny pinnace, but his appointment to the 7-man governing board is explicable only in view of the fact that he was a substantial investor in the joint stock company, shown on the records to be inscribed for £50, compared to Smith's paltry £9. It would be reasonable to assume that he had friends or relatives in high places, in the Stuart court at Whitehall, or in the Royal Council of the Virginia Company in London. Captain George Kendall, like Ratcliffe, must have had notable connections to have been named to the council. Where Ratcliffe's is an enigmatic character, Kendall's is tinged with sinister undertones. Like so many others in that first century of religious schism in England, Kendall apparently paid lip service to the Anglican Church without in fact having severed his ties with the Romish. If, as was later charged, he did indeed serve his Catholic Majesty of Spain as a spy during these first crucial months of the English colonial effort, his treachery may have been due to religious rather than venal motives. As for Captain John Martin, the next man on the list of seven, he was indisputably well-born and well-connected. His father, Sir Richard, was in his third term as Lord Mayor of London and a member of the Royal Council of the Virginia Company. Martin's brother-in-law was no less a luminary than Sir Julius Caesar, Master of the Rolls and Privy Councillor, Chancellor of the Exchequer in 1606, the year the Virginia Company received its license from the monarch. In his 40s, Captain Martin could point to some qualifications of his own. He had seen service under Sir Francis Drake and won his captaincy on the sea in a day when privateering was a way of life, preying on the Spanish treasure fleet homeward bound from Central and South America. Rank and social station alone would have similarly ensured Master Edward Mariah Wingfield his place in the ruling hierarchy. The term master or mister was not applied below the gentry. The feudal system was being transported intact from the British Isles to the New World, although it was fated to undergo some curious sea changes. But Wingfield had other reasons as well to expect preferment. He had served along with his cousin Captain Gosnold as one of the prime movers of this Chesapeake plantation, active in organizing the Virginia Company, in raising funds, in floating the stock issue. Wingfield was one of the 8 petitioners to whom the monarch granted the license authorizing the Virginia Company to colonize, officially to occupy and plant the broad lands of Virginia, which included almost the entire Atlantic seaboard of the North American continent, all save Spanish Florida far to the south. In the name of their sovereign, James I, King of England, of Scotland, of Ireland, of France, and now, it was to be hoped, King of Virginia. Sir Walter Raleigh's title to these lands had lapsed in consequence of his condemnation for treason in 1603. He had been brought to trial 4 months after the death of his fond and indulgent patroness, Queen Elizabeth. Elizabeth's successor was free in 1606 to grant the crown patent to the Virginia Company petitioners, of whom Wingfield was one. In the published list of first planters, or ancients, as the members of the very first expeditionary force came to be designated, Wingfield's name was included with those of his fellow passengers entitled by birth or station to be categorized as gentlemen. The distinction between gentlemen and others was clearly drawn in that class-conscious English society. In 17th century England, social concepts were based upon degree, as Raleigh expressed it in his History of the World, "For that infinite wisdom of God, which hath distinguished his angels by degrees, hath also ordained kings, dukes, and other degrees among men." In that very first contingent of 1607, the gentlemen, elsewhere referred to as the better sort, or men of quality, numbered 50 or more, slightly more than half the total number of 100 odd. Those who did not qualify as gentlemen were classified according to crafts or trades. 4 carpenters, 2 bricklayers, a mason, a blacksmith, a barber, a tailor, and a sailor. An even dozen nondescripts were lumped together under the heading of laborers, one without so much as a last name listed as Old Edward. 4 boys, cabin boys or grummets, are named. Going by the list published in 1612 in Smith's Map of Virginia, they had 1 drummer to keep them marching if the 2 surgeons aboard could keep them on their feet. There were divers others to the number of 105, Smith's list concludes. As for the 7-member council appointed in England to govern in America, the last name on the list, although certainly not the least, was that of the redoubtable, indomitable Captain Smith. His name, synonymous with that of the Virginia colony he helped to found, he stands first and foremost among America's founding fathers, a role of which he was, during his lifetime, already well aware. "The most of these fair plantations," he would write, meaning New England, which he explored, mapped, and named, as well as Virginia, with which his name is usually associated, "did spring from the fruits of my adventures and discoveries." Not only did Captain Smith lead the way onto this continent and make history here, he also wrote it. He served as major historian of England's westward adventure, his literary output as prodigious as his action. 11 travel adventure books published between 1608 and 1631 in a typically Elizabethan flourish. In strictly literary terms, judgment on them must be qualified. They are, to some extent, clumsily and awkwardly written chronicles, with not a few prize specimens of the lumbering complexity for which Virginia Woolf criticizes Elizabethan prose. Yet they are redeemed by passages which strike the reader as vivid and poignant, examples of the rich, ripe, resonant language in which Shakespeare wrote and the King James version of the Bible was composed. The chroniclers of Plymouth and Massachusetts Bay, William Bradford, John Winthrop, Edward Johnson, Cotton Mather, crowded Smith off the pages of New England history, but his name remains indelibly imprinted on the annals of the southern colony Virginia, England's first successful colony in North America, her first colony, for that matter, anywhere in the world, the point of origin of what would become the far-flung British Empire. If John Smith, President of Virginia and Admiral of New England, dominates the first chapter of American colonial history, there are frequent reminders that he himself penned the chapter, wielding a pen as mighty as his sword. Smith has become one of the most controversial figures in American history, a figure on a scale so heroic as to suggest the mock heroic, a figure of fun as well as folk hero, subject of travesty as of myth. And he came under a veritable barrage in the late 19th century from such anti-Southern Boston Brahmins as Henry Adams and Charles Dean. When the last word is said, however, the consensus on Smith as a historian is that his work is pretty reliable in the main. In the main, what is more, it is eminently readable. If some passages make for hard sledding, others are compelling, lively, racy, humorous. His text is imbued with his extraordinary vitality and rugged individualism, his literary style as robustuous as his lifestyle, as brash and self-assertive as his typically Elizabethan personality. As to his celebrated adventures, his feats of daring do, his travels so extensive as to put Marco Polo and Odysseus in the shade, he alone is herald to publish and proclaim them, Thomas Fuller scathingly wrote in The Worthies of England. But Fuller wrote in 1662, 31 years after Smith's death. During Smith's lifetime, no man gainsaid him, certainly not to his face. The swashbuckling Captain Smith, according to Stephen Vincent Benet, was a man who had been everywhere, been everything, or so he said, a prisoner of the Turk, or so he said, beggar in Muscovy, a paladin in Transylvania, or so he said, shipwrecked in 20 seas, lover of ladies in a dozen lands. Benet, in his American epic poem, Western Star, is paraphrasing and parodying the mundivagant author of the true travels, adventures, and observations of Captain John Smith in Europe, Asia, Africa, and America from Anno Domini 1593 to 1629. Having been a slave to the Turks, a prisoner amongst the most barbarous salvages, always in mutinies, wants, and miseries, blown up with gunpowder, prisoner among the French pirates, in the midst of wars, pestilence, and famine, by which many an 100,000 have died about me, and scarce 5 living of them that went first with me to Virginia. His life had been a succession of extreme extremities, said Annas Todkill, one of his companions in danger in the wilderness, one of the scarce 5 alive of those who had helped him to win the beachhead on the Chesapeake in 1607. John Smith had set out from England at an early age, in his 15th or 16th year, to win his spurs against the Spaniard. It was after the death of his father, sometime in 1596 or 1597, his chronology is vague, that he crossed the Channel. France and Netherlands had taught him to ride a horse and use his arms, with such rudiments of war as his tender years in those martial schools could attain to. Careers of soldiering and privateering were among the few open in that day and time to the son of a yeoman, a freeman freeholder, something more than a peasant or a laborer, something less than a gentleman, with only a rudimentary education and no connections, men of mettle and little else. No rank, no property, no profession, could hope then to win fame and fortune only in the army or the navy. Young John Smith departed those fields where Christian was fighting Christian, to find those others where Christian was fighting Moslem. He went from Flanders toward Tartary. He was desirous to see more of the world and try his fortune against the Turks, as he said in his third-person True Travels. To find the Turks, he headed east through Mediterranean ports, even Odysseus might have missed, to seas beyond to the Black Sea and the Sea of Azov. And even Richard Coeur de Lion might have paled at some of the odds confronting his fellow countrymen, the Lincolnshire lad, on those far-flung battlefields. John Smith came upon the Paynim beyond the Danube, and to fight him, enlisted in a battalion of the Imperial Army under the banner of Emperor Rudolf II of Austria. The issues at stake in Transylvania were murky. Centuries-old feuds between Magyar, Zecler, Vlach, and Saxon. For a mercenary like Captain Smith, he attained the rank shortly in the field. It was enough to know that it was the Holy Roman Empire versus the Ottoman. The 3 Turks' heads emblazoned upon Smith's shield comprised a device he had won the right to wear by 3 victorious duels in a row, on horseback, in single combat, in strict compliance with the chivalric code, against assorted Turkish challengers. The contestants entered the arena to the flourish of trumpets and hautboys, the ramparts all beset with fair dames who did long to see some court-like pastime. The first Turkish challenger, his visor pierced by Smith's lance, fell dead to the ground, where alighting and unbracing his helmet, Smith cut off his head. The second Turk survived Smith's lance only to succumb to his pistol, and lost his head as his friend before him with his horse and armor. The third combatant raised the hopes of Turkish sympathizers by resisting both Smith's pistol and his battle axe, only to fall casualty to Smith's broadsword, so that he stood not long ere he lost his head as the rest had done. But not even Smith's prowess could save the day for his battalion at Red Tower Pass, near the Moldavian frontier of eastern Wallachia, where the Khan Ghazi Garay unleashed near 40,000 Tatars in a full-scale cavalry charge, their ensigns displaying, drums beating, trumpets and hautboys sounding. And thus in this bloody field near 30,000 lay, Smith wrote, although his battle count in the opinion of military historians was often subject to inflation. But Smith among the slaughtered dead bodies and many a gasping soul, with toil and wounds lay groaning among the rest, till being found by the pillagers he was able to live, and perceiving by his armor and habit that his ransom might be better to them than his death, they led him prisoner with many others. In Axiopolis, 100 miles east of Bucharest, Smith and his fellow captives were all sold for slaves, like beasts in a marketplace. Smith fell to the lot of one Bashaw Bagal, who sent him forthwith for Constantinople to his fair mistress for a slave. By 20 and 20, chained by the necks, they marched in file to this great city, where they were delivered to their several masters, and he to the young Charatza Tragabigzanda. Whether she is to be numbered among those ladies loved by Smith in a dozen lands is nowhere clarified. Smith is more reticent about his amorous exploits than about his military ones. What little he tells about the young Greek girl from Trebizond, he tells cryptically. She took, as it seemed, much compassion on him, but having no use for him, there was presumably no place in a maiden's household for a brawny gladiator, she sent him away. Hurriedly, lest her mother sell her slave, she packed him off to her brother, who lived in a great vast stony castle, in a province in Tartaria, somewhere east of the Don. To her unkind brother this kind lady writ so much for his, Smith's, good usage, that he, her brother, half suspected as much as she intended. For she told him, Smith, he should there but sojourn to learn the language, and what it was to be a Turk, till time, and herewith the most cryptic passage of all, till time made her master of herself. However the reader may interpret Charatza's letter, the brother suspected the worst, and Smith bore the brunt of his suspicions. At his hand Smith suffered the worst of cruelty. Stripped naked, head shaven, a ring of iron riveted about his neck, among many more Christian slaves, and near 100 forçados of Turks and Moors, he, Smith, was slave of slaves to them all. All the hope he had ever to be delivered from this thraldom was only the love of Tragabigzanda, who surely was ignorant of his bad usage, so bad a dog could hardly have lived to endure. In desperation, Smith beat out the Timors, the brothers, brains with his threshing bat, clothed himself in his clothes, mounted his horse, and ran into the desert at all adventure. Lost on those trackless steppes, he was lucky to come upon a caravan route from Astrakhan to Poland, and upon the River Don, a garrison of the Muscovites. There he encountered another good lady, the Lady Kalamata, wife of the governor, who largely supplied all his wants, including a safe conduct to facilitate his journey west by convoy across the Dnieper into Lithuania, through Wallonia, Polonia, Hungaria, Moravia, Bohemia, Saxony, Brunswick, Bavaria, the Palatinate, Lorraine, and so finally to France, which he had left 3 years earlier. Being thus satisfied with Europe and Asia, he went from Gibraltar to Ghouta and Tangier to the Barbary coast. There he rejected the idea of joining in a local war among three Bernoust princes, resolving instead to join an old fox of a naval captain on a French man of war to try some other conclusions at sea. Those conclusions were frankly piratical, but they led at long last back home. The final page of part one of Smith's True Travels, Adventures, and Observations bears no date, though it was probably 1604, the year after Queen Elizabeth's death. But the last line reads, "And then he, Captain John Smith, a veteran of foreign wars, and probably in his 24th year, returned into England." How true are they, Captain Smith's true travels? There's the question. Once raised, it set off a controversy that still echoes around his name. Hero or impostor? To poke fun is a perennial temptation. The feats he describes are death-defying. His hairbreadth escapes challenge credulity. His chronology is vague. His mathematics is fanciful. His travel itinerary is difficult to trace because his spelling of place names and proper names is idiosyncratic. Many of those names had an exotic ring to his English ear. Furthermore, it should be noted, irregular and inconsistent orthography was characteristic of his century. To authenticate Smith's travels and adventures is as difficult as to discredit them. Attempts have been made, intermittently, to do either one or the other. The Smith works may continue to be mistrusted by some scholars, but they cannot be ignored in any consideration of America's beginnings. In the words of Alexander Brown, eminent turn-of-the-century historian, "When our age of reflection arrived, Smith's history was almost the only source from which we derived any knowledge of the infancy of our state. And it came to be regarded as standard authority on our foundation, and its author as our founder." As regards Smith's wide military experience, his valor and resourcefulness, the proof lies not in his works but in his persona, his irresistible authority, his imposing presence. He took command as naturally as he took breath. He asked none of his men to go where he would not lead them himself. Men followed where he led, and most of those who survived the landing on the Chesapeake were those who followed him rather than another. The wars in Europe, Asia, and Africa taught me how to subdue the wild savages in Virginia and New England in America. When Captain Newport opened the sealed box of orders on April 26th, on that sandy shore off Cape Henry, and read aloud the list of counselors appointed by the Virginia Company to govern in the colony, the name of Captain John Smith would have been greeted with approval. The approval of all save Master Wingfield and his faction. In their eyes, the admittance of a yeoman, a social inferior to the ruling elite, was a violation of the caste system. Did not, in Shakespeare's phrase, the heavens themselves, the planets, and this center, observe degree, priority, and place? In Wingfield's Elizabethan world, political authority was identified with social authority. Smith's very presence, exuding authority at every pore, reeking of brash self-confidence, the cut of his jib, the jut of his jaw, implied a challenge to Wingfield's birthright of precedence. A confrontation between the two had been inevitable during the course of that grueling long voyage. It came at the Canary Islands, and any issue could have served to spark it. How many barrels of water to put aboard? How many of sack? What bait to use in what waters? Whether to spit to windward or to leeward? Anything or nothing. Any challenge to his own authority, Wingfield would have construed as mutiny. It was apparently on Wingfield's charge of concealing an intended mutiny that Smith was placed under arrest in mid-February. And it could only have been at the instigation of Wingfield and his faction, such factions we had as commonly attend such voyages, that a pair of gallows was made at Nevis, in the Leeward Isles, in late March, although Captain Smith, for whom they were intended, could not, in the captain's own saucy phrase, be persuaded to use them. And it was, in all likelihood, at Wingfield's contrivance, that the other six members of the council voted to disqualify Captain Smith from service on that governing board until the issue of his guilt should be resolved. The other six councilmen, in compliance with the sealed instructions, were sworn into service and conducted a vote for president, electing Wingfield, who was the ranking member. The first order of business for the newly elected president and his council, in concert with Captain Newport, was the selection of a plantation site in accordance with Virginia Company instructions. Captain Newport conducted a series of exploratory trips up the James River, while the fleet waited at anchor in the bay off Old Point Comfort. Newport chose the James because of the direction of its flow. The fact that it could be sailed toward the west raised hopes that it might point the way to the long-sought Northwest Passage, shortcut to the Orient, that will-o'-the-wisp of 17th-century exploration. The James did not lead to the Pacific, but even so it was one of the famousest rivers that ever was found by any Christian, to quote the irrepressibly enthusiastic Percy, riding with Newport in the shallop. It ebbs and flows 103 miles where ships of Great Burthen may harbor in safety. And it had many branches, which run flowing through the woods, with great plenty of fish of all kinds, and all the grounds bespread with many sweet and delicate flowers of divers colors and kinds, as though it had been in any garden or orchard in England. The James River, known to the original inhabitants as the Powhatan, rises in the Allegheny Mountains, flowing and winding 340 miles eastward to empty into the bay through Hampton Roads, as it is called today. A broad stream, broader than the Thames at its mouth, torpid, sluggish, rippling only to the rhythm of the tides, to the swoop of a gull or the leap of a fish, to the swath of a fin or the stroke of a paddle. The plantation site favored by Captain Newport and endorsed by President Wingfield and his council was on the banks of the James, just below its confluence with the Chickahominy River. A site some 40 miles upstream, inland from the open waters of the bay, out of reach of surprise attack by prowling Spaniards, defensible at a point where the river narrows, thus in compliance with the chief requirements for safety prescribed by the Virginia Company in the matter of site selection for the colony. The site selected was on a low-lying wooded peninsula, a strip of land almost rectangular, about 2 miles long and one wide, containing some 1,500 acres of high land suitable for cultivation. The peninsula was connected at that time to the mainland by a narrow sandbar. Its erosion in ensuing centuries left Jamestown, as today, an island. The site was appealing to a mariner not only because of its defensibility, but because of its deep water landing, facilitating the loading and unloading of cargo. The Susan Constant, the Godspeed, and the Discovery, riding in 6 fathoms of water, could be moored to ancient cypresses overhanging the river. The advantages were immediately apparent. The disadvantages, the dangers lurking in the miasmal swamp, were less readily recognizable. Captain Newport was responsible for the choice of the planting site on the James River, but the choice of the region, the Chesapeake instead of the Carolina Barrier Reefs upon which Raleigh's colonial hopes had foundered, had been made, sight unseen, by Richard Hakluyt, ranking geographer of an age in which geography ranked as the most popular science. Preacher Hakluyt, as he continued to be called long after he had forsaken the pulpit for the Globe, served not only as chief propagandist for the Virginia Company venture of 1607, he was one of the original 6 signatories to the charter petition, but as a prime mover in the westward surge of the entire English colonization movement, one of the first to collect and publish the early material relating to the New World, Hakluyt was also one of the first to perceive its immense potential. His Principal Navigations, Voyages, Traffics, and Discoveries of the English Nation stands as the classic statement of the case for English colonization. Beyond that, it has been called the prose epic of the English nation, and accounted one of the more influential books in England's history. Shakespeare was among its readers. Although Hakluyt's selection of the Chesapeake region was predicated largely on guesswork, it was educated guesswork, as in the case of the scientist's selection of the site for the first moon landing. Hakluyt had had access to some fragmentary accounts of exploration in that area. Captain Philip Amadis, with the Portuguese Simão Fernandes as pilot, may have penetrated the waters of the Chesapeake in 1584-1585 on an expedition for Sir Walter Raleigh. Bartholomew Gilbert possibly entered the bay in 1603. Verrazzano missed the strait between the capes by the merest of miles in 1524. One or more Spanish ships had almost surely sailed those waters in 1571-1572, and the Roanoke Island colonists are known to have dispatched a small scouting party northward in 1585 in the direction of the Chesapeake to explore and to map. Hakluyt's choice of the region proved fortunate. The largest bay on the Atlantic coast of the North American continent, its broad reaches promised superlative roadsteads for the maritime traffic that would one day grow up between the mother country and the new English nation, as Raleigh, an incorrigible optimist even on the headsman's block, envisioned it. Sadly, Hakluyt, still in his 50s but considered too old for such an adventure, was never to see with his own eyes that glistening, bounteous blue breast of the Chesapeake, billowing up out of a corsage of golden sands, dunes, beaches, spume-flecked and sown with sea oats, saltbush, bayberry. As for Tidewater, Virginia, that coastal strip extending back some 100 miles to the western fall line, to the Appalachian Piedmont, not even Hakluyt could have foreseen such a geographical curiosity. A land enthralled to the sea, subject to the ebb and flow of the tide through the estuaries, deep into the interior. 5 of the rivers, the James, the York, the Piankatank, the Rappahannock, and the Potomac, spread out like 5 fingers of a giant hand, thrusting into the land and dividing it into verdant strips and peninsulas. Tidewater, Virginia, was environed, crossed, streaked, laced, and ribboned by water, which was as vital an element in its composition as earth. A labyrinth of estuaries, streams, and swamps, a low, flat, fertile land, pine and cypress forested, alive with game, a reservoir of salt water and fresh, with the bounty of seafare peculiar to such a combination. Of the several peninsulas formed by Virginia's major estuaries, the one lying between the James River and the York is referred to as the Peninsula, sometimes as the Cradle of the Republic, an 80-mile-long tongue of land reaching from Old Point Comfort to Richmond. It was here that the council decided to plant the colony and to name it Jamestown or James Fort, in honor like the river of their king. On May 14th, the square-rigged linen flax sails furled and secured, the 3 ships were moored to trees overhanging the bank, and the unloading began. The bare necessities of provisioning and equipment for the settlement were set ashore. Seamen and settlers alike must have rushed to disembark, their longing for terra firma unassuaged by an occasional brief excursion from ship to shore and back to ship again. They were eager to feel solid ground instead of a heaving deck under their feet, to expel the reek of bilge water from their lungs, and to breathe in pine-fresh air instead, to stretch themselves, to stand straight, stand alone, after the long months penned up together in those dark, cramped shipboard quarters. They could congratulate themselves on having survived an Atlantic crossing. Formal Thanksgiving services had been conducted by their gentle chaplain, Robert Hunt, on April 29th at Cape Henry, where a commemorative cross had been erected. These mariners and adventurers constituted a rare breed of men, found in every generation, the first to go up in the flying machine or down in the submarine, the first to rocket into outer space. After the meager shipboard diet of hardtack, corned meat, and weevily gruel en route from England, no wonder Sir George Percy exclaimed in delight at the bounty of the Chesapeake, at the great variety as well as plenty of fish and shellfish, at the good store of mussels and oysters, which lay on the ground as thick as stones and large and delicate in taste, not to mention the sturgeon, since all the world cannot be compared to it, or the turkey nests and many eggs, the strawberries, raspberries, mulberries, and fruits unknown. No wonder Percy called it this paradise. And Captain Smith, still denied his seat on the council, but finally free of physical restraint, echoed Percy's elation. Such pleasant plains, hills, and fertile valleys, one prettily crossing another, and watered so conveniently with their sweet brooks and crystal springs, as if art itself had devised them. The 14th day of May we landed all our men, according to Percy's diary, the only detailed account of those first weeks ashore, which were set to work about the fortification, and others some to watch and ward, as it was convenient. Now falleth every man to work, even the gentlemen, as one of them, Thomas Studley, reported in The Proceedings of the English Colony in Virginia. The council contrived the fort, the rest cut down trees to make place to pitch their tents, Some provide clapboard to relay the ships, some make gardens, some nets, etc. There was a rush to sow the seeds of English wheat, oats, and barley in a spring season already far advanced. The fort contrived by the council was to be triangular in shape, covering approximately an acre of ground, and fenced against the still unknown dangers of the wilderness surrounding them. The red men, the principal danger of the wilderness, had allowed themselves to be seen infrequently after that initial brush with the landing party near Cape Henry on April 26th, the day of landfall. Percy, as a member of another small reconnoitering party on the 27th, expressed disappointment that "we could not see a savage in all that march." During the next few days, discovering farther up the bay in the shallop, they came upon signs of human life. A canoe, made out of a whole tree, 5 and 40 feet long by the rule. Then, still deeper in the woods, great smokes of fire. But all this march, we could neither see savage nor town. Still, the savages had been there, burning down the grass. As we thought either to make their plantation there or else to give signs to bring their forces together and to give us battle. Finally, on the 30th day of the month, at the point they had named Point Comfort, they saw 5 savages running on the shore. Captain Newport, ordering the shallop to be rowed to the shore, called to them in sign of friendship, signs he had learned in previous encounters with the aborigines of the Western Hemisphere. At Newport's sign, hand on heart, a universal symbol of goodwill and truth, they laid down their bows and arrows and beckoned the English to their town, Kikotan. There we were entertained by them very kindly, and very ceremoniously. A feast was spread, a pipe smoked, a dance performed. On the 4th day of May we came to the king, or Werowance, an Algonquian word the English had learned from Raleigh's Roanoke Island adventurers, of Paspahig, where they entertained us with much welcome. As did the Rappahannock, who entertained the visitors from across the sea in good humanity. Up and down the James, the 2 ritual shouts, the protocol of welcome among the Algonquian tribes of Virginia, rang out more often than not at the approach of the English oarsmen. Up and down both seaboards, the Atlantic and the Pacific, men from across the sea were in the first instance greeted cordially, welcomed by the native inhabitants. North American natives were usually friendly to the first Europeans they encountered, and hostile only after being abused or cheated, in the judgment of Samuel Eliot Morrison. On the West Coast, in his voyage of 1579-1580, Sir Francis Drake blushed at being hailed as a god by people of a tractable, free, and loving nature without guile or treachery. At being offered tribute, baskets filled with an herb they called taba, tobacco. On the East Coast, far to the north in Newfoundland, in 1501, Gaspar Corte Real had only praise for the Beothuks, for their manners and gestures most gentle. Who could have dreamed those gentle Beothuks would soon be exterminated, hunted down like wild beasts by the French and English? At the Rock of Quebec in 1535, the Hurons flocked to the banks of the St. Lawrence to greet Jacques Cartier. While the chiefs made orations, the women danced and sang, wading knee-deep into the river to serenade the longboat, their song of welcome carrying miles downstream to the flagship. The Italian Verrazzano, on a French exploratory mission along the southerly coasts of the Atlantic seaboard in 1524, met with divers signs of friendship from very courteous and gentle red men. Farther north in New York Bay, at the Narrows, since renamed in Verrazzano's honor, the people, clad with feathers of fowls of divers colors, came toward us very cheerfully, making great shouts of admiration, showing us where we might come to land most safely with our boat. The Wampanoags of Massachusetts were hospitable, helpful, pleasant, too. Verrazzano's judgment was to be corroborated a century later by such prominent New England chroniclers as Roger Williams, William Wood, Thomas Morton, and Daniel Gookin. The Abenaki were the exception, howling, jeering, obscene, exhibiting their backsides and laughing immoderately, giving Maine a bad name on Verrazzano's brother's map, Terra onde di mala gente, the land of bad people. Elsewhere, initial contacts were idyllic. In the country Wingandacoa, now named Virginia by Her Majesty, a smiling king made signs of joy and welcome to Amadis and Barlow, captains of Raleigh's 1584 expedition, when they disembarked upon his shore, somewhere probably along the coastline of present-day Georgia. The signs made by the king, striking his own head and breast and then ours, were meant to show that we were all brothers, all made of the same flesh. Barlow declared, "We have never in the world so far encountered a more kind and loving people. We were entertained with kindness and friendship and were given everything they could provide. We found these people gentle, loving, and faithful, lacking all guile and trickery. It was as if they lived in a golden age of their own." And Thomas Harriot, in his 1585 encounter with the tribes of the North Carolina Barrier Reefs, was similarly impressed. He could not remember having ever seen a better or gentler folk than these. But to begin at the beginning is to begin with Columbus. The reception accorded him, the first white man ever seen by the red, was friendly. The pleasant island that the Santa Maria came upon in the warm blue Caribbean Sea, probably San Salvador, full of green trees and abounding in springs, was inhabited by a multitude of people, though not such a multitude that they could not shortly be exterminated, all the Bahamas all too soon depopulated by the Spaniards, who hastened to the shore, astounded and marveling at the sight of the ships. The admiral, perceiving they were a gentle, peaceful, and very simple people, gave them little red caps and glass beads which they hung about their necks. Even so, first blood was drawn there in the Bahamas in 1492, for when the Christians showed them a naked sword, they foolishly grasped it by the blade and cut themselves. Only a nick, only skin deep, but the wound was mortal. The native inhabitants were to be exsanguinated upon that cold steel by the technological superiority of the invader. The Spaniards were responsible, it is estimated, for at least 6 million deaths in the Caribbean. At Jamestown, just over a century later, President Wingfield avoided any show of weaponry. He would admit no exercise at arms or fortification, but the boughs of trees cast together in the form of a half-moon. He came in for criticism, from Thomas Studley, among others, but he was only following the instructions of the Royal Council in London, not to offend the naturals if you can eschew it. The council in Virginia could not have guessed that they had offended the naturals by the very choice of the site for their plantation. They had trespassed by locating their colony on an ancient hunting ground of the Paspahegh tribe, though it appeared unoccupied ground to Captain Smith. Where now is Jamestown, then a thick grove of trees? It was, in fact, a second growth, and recent archaeological work has established the fact that the tongue of land on which the English settlement was located had been, within the previous century, an Indian campground, probably Paspahegh. Relocating a village and its encompassing fields, to let the land lie fallow, was a common practice, the sole method of land rejuvenation known to primitive cultivators of the soil. In spite of tribal rivalries and conflict, one tribe's territorial rights were respected by the others in the region. A tribe identified itself with a specific area characterized by sacred landmarks and place names, to which its rituals and mythology related. In a sense, the land was an integral part of the tribe's religion. Abounding in beauty and tradition, as well as in game and fish, it provided sustenance for soul as well as body. It was in this sense that the Black Hills were the religion of the Sioux. The loss of the land in 1875 at the time of the gold rush, in flagrant violation of the Treaty of 1851, which had guaranteed them its possession in perpetuity, was not simply a material calamity for the tribe, but a spiritual one as well. "The first night of our landing, about midnight," Sir George Percy noted in his diary, "there came some savages sailing close to our quarter. Presently there was an alarm given. Upon that the savages ran away, and we were not troubled any more by them that night. although those savages doubtless paddled their canoe swiftly back to the Werowance of Paspahegue to report developments on the spit of land in the James where the three sailing ships were moored. The newcomers had been under constant surveillance since their arrival. The great smokes of fire seen by Percy in the woods were very probably signals, as he suspected, to other lookouts across the river, across the bay, up and down the coastline from Point Comfort, to the Warrisquiox and Nansemonds to the south, to the Kikotans and the Chisiacs to the north, to the Accomacs on the eastern shore. Drums were used as well as smoke signals. The drums, which could be heard for great distances, especially along the water, would have beat out a prompt alarm. A report on the three white-winged ships and the white-skinned armored men aboard would have been on its way within hours after the first sail breached the strait to the supreme chieftain of the region's tribes at his principal residence far up the Pamunkey. "Watchful he is over us, and keeps good espial upon our proceedings," as colonist William Strachey would later report, "concerning which he hath his sentinels, that at what time soever any of our boats, pinnaces, or ships come in, fall down, or make up the river, give the alarm, and take it quickly the one from the other. On foot along the narrow, tortuous woodland trails, and so finally to the Pamunkey River. The alarm given by the sentinels, it was taken quickly the one from the other, until it reach and come even to the court or hunting house, wheresoever he and his counselors and priests are." Note, from William Strachey, History of Travel into Virginia, Britannia. End of note. The he to whom Strachey refers being the great Powhatan, chief of chiefs, Werowance of Werowances, holding sway over a confederacy of 30 or more tidewater tribes, making his headquarters on the north bank of the Pamunkey River at Wirowocomoco. If it was not properly speaking a court, as Strachey with his old-world monarchical concepts termed it, then it was Powhatan's stronghold, his seat of government, his palace, his sanctuary, his ossuary, his treasure house. Chapter 2. That unripe side of earth, that heavy clime, that gives us man up now like Adam's time before he ate. John Donne. The sovereignty of the supreme chieftain Powhatan extended over virtually all tidewater Virginia, the entire coastal belt stretching 100 miles inland to the fall line on the west, and including the peninsula across the strait, the eastern shore, an area approximately one-fifth of the present-day state. The Powhatan Confederacy included most of the Algonquian-speaking tribes in the Tidewater country. Hostile Siouan and Iroquoian tribes occupied the other four-fifths of what is now the state. The Algonquian language family to which the Powhatan tribes of Virginia belonged was one of the largest and most widespread on the North American continent. Algonquian dialects were to be heard all the way across the continent from Labrador to beyond Hudson Bay, in the Great Lakes region, in the Mississippi Valley. Not that a common language was indicative of a common cultural level. Algonquian was the tongue of primitive nomadic hunting bands in the subarctic, devoid of all but the most rudimentary societal organization. Algonquian was the tongue as well of culturally advanced corn growers in the south, along the north and central Atlantic seaboard, agricultural societies boasting fairly complex and sophisticated political structures. Algonquian was one of the five major linguistic stocks of this continent, one as different from the other as English from Bantu, Hebrew from Chinese. These five major stocks are thought to represent five major waves of migration, each of the five peoples with a different language, different origins, different background, that came to the Americas from different regions of Asia tens of thousands of years ago. Archaeologists make educated guesses ranging anywhere from 12 or 15,000 to 30,000 years ago, sometime toward the end of the Ice Age. At that time, the Narrows, a mere 56 miles, between Siberia and Alaska were spanned by a land bridge which had come into existence as the sea levels fell, as the receding waters of the glacial age exposed the bed of the shallow Bering Strait. note. This theory does not preclude the possibility that when the land bridge disappeared at the close of the Ice Age, some 10,000 years ago, other migrants from Asia came to this continent by boat across the open waters of the narrow Bering Strait, as the Eskimo Aleuts were believed to have done. End of note. Having crossed from one continent to the other, these groups of hunters of mongoloid stock dispersed south and east, following the big game herds along the ice-free valleys which served as avenues across and down the North American continent. Some settled there. Others continued through Central America and on to South America. On and on, until Land's End was reached at Tierra del Fuego. This theory of the peopling of the Western Hemisphere is the consensus of 20th century science. As late as the third quarter of the 20th century, no evidence has come to light to refute it. To date, archaeological research in the Americas has turned up no traces of a pre-Homo sapiens type of man, such as have been discovered in Europe, Asia, and Africa. A fact leading to the conclusion that the man who settled this hemisphere must have arrived already well along the long evolutionary road, already equipped to settle new continents. The first act was evidently not played out here. Columbus's Renaissance world had no such scientific consensus to explain the presence of man in a region where man had not been thought to exist. A fourth quarter of a world thought until that time to be tripartite. It was the passage to India that Columbus had sailed to seek. It was the East Indies he thought he sighted in that blue Bahaman sea on October 12, 1492. Once Columbus had determined that the isles he found were not off the coast of Asia, neither Cathay nor Cipango, then it followed that the inhabitants were not Indians after all, though the misnomer stuck. But if not Indians, what were they? It was the question every troubled European from Columbus on was to ask himself at sight of those red men of the newfound land. If not descendants of Noah, and they could not be, since Noah had only three sons, whose descendants were already accounted for in Europe, Libya, and Asia, according to Judeo-Christian cosmology and doctrine, they could not count their descent from Adam. In which case they could not be accounted part of the Judeo-Christian creation scheme. In that case, did they have souls? Were they members of the human race? It was the point upon which the issue of slavery depended. If the red men were subhuman, beasts of the forest, they were subject to enslavement like any other beast of burden. The debate as to whether the Indians had souls continued into the 16th century. Even as the Church at Rome debated the point, Pope Paul III finding at long last in the affirmative, philosophers pondered the question Columbus had posed when he first set foot on San Salvador. What manner of people might these redskins be? Did they have their origin in the lost continent of Atlantis or Mu? Did they belong to one of the 10 lost tribes of Israel? So the Puritans contended, so do the Mormons to this day. Might they be moon children gone amiss? Lunar changelings? Such was the theory proposed by Francis Godwin in his mid-17th century science fiction story, The Man in the Moon. Note. By Godwin's theory, the people of the moon exchange their wayward children for earthlings, sending their own, who do amiss, to a certain high hill in the north of America, whose people I can easily believe to be wholly descended of them, partly in regard of their color, partly also in regard of the continual use of tobacco which lunars use exceeding much. Francis Godwin, The Man in the Moon, A Story of Space Travel. Hereford, The Hereford Times, 1959. End of note. To these questions, few answers were forthcoming. The times prior to the arrival of Columbus in America belong, for the most part, to prehistory. Eons of time without a written record, vast regions of land space with scarce a monument. The two huge continents yield few clues to archaeological research. In South America, the ruins of Inca and pre-Inca civilization long lay inaccessible in the Andes. It is in Central America and Mexico where most of the evidence available is to be found. The pyramids of Teotihuacan, the ziggurats of Yucatan and Guatemala, the rare Mayan codices to survive the Spanish invaders' torch, though without a Rosetta Stone to illuminate them. Elsewhere not so much as are men here standing and the minimal archaeological rubble. Prehistory guards its secrets well. Whereas it has been established that man was present in the northeastern area of North America as long as 10,000 years ago, there remain only his spear points and his grinding stones among the bones of the game he hunted to attest his presence, and only new radiocarbon and Rochalt dating techniques to enable the archaeologists to attribute the artifact to the proper period. A number of prehistoric cultures flowered in the Ohio and Mississippi valleys, mound-building cultures characterized by a cult of the dead, an elaborate funeral ritual, and funerary arts. The influence of these cultural centers made itself felt all along a well-established trade network that extended into the Great Lakes region and up and down the Atlantic coastline, including the northeast woodlands. Here across the northern forest zone from Minnesota and the Great Lakes to the St. Lawrence Valley and New England, a series of interrelated cultures developed and a culture pattern was set to serve the prehistoric ancestors of historic tribes, the tribes that would be known to history as Siouan, Iroquoian, and Algonquian. The cultural pattern common to all the historic tribes throughout this region has been designated by anthropologists as the Northeastern Woodlands type. Tradition had it that numbers of Algonquian-speaking peoples, bands of primitive nomadic hunters, had changed their habitat from the northernmost extremity of the Northeast Woodlands area to the Chesapeake Bay area, moving south several centuries before the English landing there in 1607, sometime about the 14th century. Thus said at least a Powhatan tribal tradition current in the early 17th century. Archaeological proof has yet to be produced in substantiation of the legend. Moving south, these people had exchanged a rigorous subarctic environment for a tidewater land of waters teeming with fish, shellfish overflowing onto the beaches into the very hands of the gatherer, and forests filled with game, abounding in wild fruits, berries, nuts. The fertile Virginia soil yielded 4-yearly corn harvests. Fields were planted near hunting and fishing grounds. The struggle for survival no longer absorbed the major life force of the people. The Algonquian-speaking newcomers acquired new skills, exercised new talents, devised well-ordered and impressively complex political systems to accommodate and coordinate the constantly increasing population, revised religious, social, and political hierarchies, strengthened central authority, established chiefdoms, and in the late 16th century formed a confederacy, a political phenomenon exclusive to the Atlantic seaboard, in evidence from Maine to Virginia. These were the Powhatan tribes of Virginia, and this was the cultural stage they had attained at the time of their first encounter with the white invader. When the English landed on the banks of the James in 1607, the Algonquian tribes of the Chesapeake Bay region were still in the process of consolidating their confederacy. The confederacy had been the creation and had taken the name of its supreme chieftain, Powhatan, who had adopted the name of his natal tribe. Powhatan had inherited sovereignty over a nucleus of 6 cognate tribes and territories within a 50-mile radius of present-day Richmond. The Powhatan, Arahatuck, Appomattock, Yotanund, Mattapony, and Pamunkey tribes, most taking their names from the rivers on whose banks they dwelt, composed an already unified intertribal organization with strong social ties and a communality of culture. The rest of the Tidewater Algonquian tribes, 2 dozen or more, had been brought under Powhatan's dominion somewhere around the turn of the century, either by force of arms or by strategic maneuver. John Smith's True Relation lists 28 tribes in the Powhatan Confederation, while his map of 1612 shows 36 king's houses, or tribal capitals in the Powhatan sphere of influence, along with 161 villages, large and small, whose chiefs and sub-chiefs, local and regional werowances, all rendered homage and paid tribute to Powhatan. looking to him for the maintenance of peace within the Confederacy and for defense against the alien Sioux and Iroquois who surrounded and occasionally raided the Tidewater territory of the Algonquians. The Powhatan League of Tribes lacked the power and elaborate political structure of its contemporary, the Iroquois Confederacy. It lacked the idealistic concepts, the primitive democratic elements, the elements of representative government apparent in the latter, concepts and elements which may have exerted an influence on the democratic political theory later to be developed in the colonies. Note: Frederick Jackson Turner's famous phrase, "Democracy came out of the forest," could have alluded to the Iroquois, if not the Powhatan Confederacy. End of note. But Thomas Jefferson was justified in applying the term Confederacy to the Powhatan bloc. It was a well-structured political organization developed for the purpose of peacekeeping and trade, without undue interference in the domestic autonomy of the member tribes. Not that Powhatan's control was absolute and unchallenged at the turn of the century. The tribes at the periphery of the empire, those farthest removed from central authority, most frequently and most successfully defied it. Some few large and powerful tribes, closer to the base of power, might occasionally insist on pursuing an independent policy, as would happen in reaction to the English invasion crisis. Insubordinate tribes were disciplined, either relocated in areas where closer surveillance could be exerted over them, or subjected to the rule of one of Powhatan's trusty allies or kinsmen. His three brothers, Opechapan, Kikato, and Opechancano, were in command of the heavily populated Pamunkey River region. Two of Powhatan's sons served him as tribal chieftains. Parahunt, or Tanks Powhatan as the English called him, over the Powhatans, Pochins over the Kikotans. Powhatan was in the process of extending and consolidating his empire precisely when the English burst upon the scene. Given time, he might have succeeded in expelling hostile Siouan tribes of the Piedmont, in extending the Confederacy's frontiers north of the Potomac or south of the Nottoway. It was overall a time of expansion, of florescence, for the Northeast Woodlands cultures. The position of the Virginia Algonquians in the early 17th century was distinctly advantageous. In the security provided them by the Confederation, enjoying the natural bounty of the Chesapeake and practicing a few provident techniques to preserve and store that bounty out of season, they could further develop their social institutions and refine their culture. By Aboriginal standards, the population of the Confederacy was large, 8,500 to 9,000 outnumbering all the rest of the Virginia Indian tribes combined. The Tidewater Algonquians, settled and well-housed in secure villages surrounded by cultivated fields, could support a denser population than could the semi-nomadic hunting and gathering tribes in the other parts of Virginia. Primitive is a misleading adjective for a society as sophisticated and complex as that of the Powhatans, with its well-defined class distinctions and social controls, with its occupational specializations and orderly secular hierarchy of command. The distribution of supplies through exchange as practiced by the tribes of the Confederacy was an economic concept that had its parallel in European society. The notable artifacts that survive give proof that there was a religious and aesthetic motivation as well as a utilitarian purpose in the mind of the maker. From James Fort on the James River to Wirowo Komoko on the Pamunkey was only 14 or 15 miles as the crow flies. But it was farther for the runner on the tortuous forest trails or for the boatman along the circuitous waterways, 6 or 7 hours on foot or by canoe. As soon as Powhatan received word of white men on his shores, he would have summoned his counselors to join him in a conference, to consult the omens, to confront the crisis, and to consider the options open to them in dealing with it. The European white man was not a totally unknown quantity to the Indians around Chesapeake Bay. They had already known him either by direct contact or by hearsay for something like 100 years. Intertribal trade was the conduit for news. North and south, up and down the coast, as well as east and west, as far west as the Great Lakes, exchange of news and cultural ideas accompanied the exchange of goods for generations. The most highly prized ornaments and utensils of the Virginia Indians were of copper, as the English observed in the early 1600s. The metal must have been imported from the Lake Superior region, obtained in trade for coastal pearls and shells, which have turned up in inland archaeological excavations. Word had undoubtedly been passed up from the Gulf Coast after 1520, when the Spaniards began their slave raids there to rebuild the labor forces of their West Indies plantations to replace the native Caribbean islanders who were being so rapidly exterminated. The kidnapping started in 1496 when Columbus seized 30 red-skinned, paint-daubed, befeathered creatures from Hispaniola for shipment back to Granada to titillate the court of Ferdinand and Isabella. The Virginia Indians would surely have heard in 1524 from their Algonquian-speaking neighbors immediately to the south on the Carolina banks that a great ship from beyond the seas had appeared inside the barrier reef. The ship was La Dauphine, with Verrazzano in command. Although he was courteously received, his French crew reciprocated by snatching a child from its mother's arms, not to mention a young woman, which was very beautiful and of tall stature, whom they tried unsuccessfully to abduct, could not possibly, for the great outcries that she made, bring her to the sea. The early French and English voyages did not go in for professional slaving as did the Portuguese. They kidnapped merely to collect interesting specimens of the exotic fauna of this newfound land, live souvenirs of their travels, living proof of their discoveries. There is evidence, but no conclusive proof, that the Indians of the Chesapeake area had direct contact with European white men in 1570 or 1571, when a Spanish Jesuit mission was founded on the York River. Its destruction by the Indians is said to have been avenged in 1572 by a punitive expedition sent up from a Spanish base in Florida. After the Spaniards' depredations along the southern and central Atlantic coast, the natives could have formed no favorable impression of the white man. Sir Richard Grenville, leading the Raleigh expedition to the Carolina banks in 1584-1585, did nothing to ameliorate that impression, when in retaliation for a theft, he set fire to a Secatan village on the Pamlico River, where he had admittedly been well entertained. At Aquascagoc, the Indians stole a silver cup, wherefore we burnt the town and spoiled their corn. The first English atrocity on that shore. Thomas Harriot, the brilliant polymath poet Magus, delegated by his pupil patron friend Sir Walter Raleigh to sail as surveyor and historian of the expedition, deplored his companion's overreaction. "Some of our company showed themselves too furious upon causes that on our part might have been borne with more mildness."
Powhatan had doubtless... We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.